I'm Howard Callahan. I work out of the office in Talbot County. I cover Talbot, Queen Anne's, and Kent counties as my territory. But again, there's like nine of me, I think, in the state in today's world. So we're all out there kind of doing the same thing, just a different region. Hans and them talked about AIRs, annual implementation reports. That's always, like you say, that data is getting used more and more and more. It's very important information. So we need them filled out. We need them filled out as accurate as we can get them. Me, in this region, there's always a resource. You got the extension, you got your consultants. If you got questions, call us, ask us, whatever. We'll help you get through it. But again, it's something we've got to do. Again, for 2015, forms were mailed, again, early January. They're due back March 1, so it's coming very quick. I don't have an exact number, but give or take a little, we've got about 70% in my region, and that's usually about what we get about this time of the year. But again, we need to get the others. We'll, like everything else, you know, there'll be follow-up. There'll be hammering to get them. So if you haven't done them, try to get them done. The form for this year basically is the same it was for last year, other than they added one item to some degree, and that basically was to do with manure that is being imported or exported from the state of Maryland. Someone thought that was important to get some idea of what manure is flowing in or out of the state. So that was added. That was kind of brand new. So it's not uncommon that as time evolves, someone thinks they got a new question they need an answer for. So that was something that's kind of brand new. Basically, that's just a snippet of the form. Like I said, really not anything different until you get down here where it's talking about imported and exported. And this part right here for this year is focused on the state of Maryland. You jump to the next page. It's the same thing, and it's imported or exported from somewhere other than the state of Maryland, and you just list the state. My understanding, this came to light, there was something going on northern part of Maryland to do with Pennsylvania, and somewhere someone made a comment about 16,000 tons of manure coming into the state of Maryland from Pennsylvania, and that got people excited, so then they want to know, well, how much is coming and going? So we're hoping that's going to help us give a handle on some of that. So again, fill it out. It's a lot to it, but you walk through it step by step. You fill out what's relevant. You make sure you sign it. Because again, that's your agreement that you're keeping your plans up to date. That's what we use for measuring compliance. Again, here's just listing your crops, whatever. But again, I'm gonna jump through some of this. There's handouts of my PowerPoint should be on the chairs, but if not, there's some more here so you can have them later. And I'm gonna go through two or three things. Again, talking about just timing of manure applications. Again, makes no difference whether it's spring or fall. They still got to be incorporated within 48 hours, other than there are a few exceptions. If you're prying manure in the fall, in reality, we're hoping it's going on a crop that's going to be growing, but sometimes you get in a dairy situation or whatever where manure is not stackable. It's got to go out. They may be putting it on fallow land, but again, they have to plant at least a cover crop. Again, winter applications. Basically, again, it's where if it's stackable, dry, like poultry litter, it has to be stacked. Again, if it's liquid, we don't have storage. Those are things we're all working towards. Again, there's exceptions, you know, if it's coming out of the animal or permanent pasture, highly erodible land, some of those don't have to incorporate. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that. We'll never get through. Again, the key is if you're dealing with liquid manure, and I know most of us in this region are not, but if you are, we got to be coming up with something realistic plan to figure out what we're going to do for winter applications. Again, you need to be talking to your soil conservation district if you're interested in cost share, because we're headed to basically come July of 2016, which is just around the corner. No winter spreading is allowed for any farms with more than 50 animal units. So the small dairies, to some degree, or the small ones, got until 2020. But again, if you know that's your situation, you need to be coming up with a plan of how we're going to deal with it. So that's very important. Again, you can stockpile. It's something that's considered temporary. You know, we're staging manure, getting ready to spread it later, like Jenny said. Again, this talks about stockpiling, and, you know, it's really common sense. But try to use your storage. You know, it's only supposed to be staged there temporarily. You're supposed to heap it up. That kind of stuff, so common sense. Another thing that is not brand new, but it's kind of new, is dealing with setbacks for nutrient application. That actually came into play in 2012 regulations. went into effect in 2014, so we're a few years in. But we've noticed that over the last year or so, we haven't been seeing that addressed to the degree that it needs to be addressed. So it's something that's getting a little more attention than it had in the past. It's so something you need to be aware of. Your consultant should be making you aware of it. But again, assuming your setback applies, it's basically a vegetative area where no nutrient-containing material can be applied. Well, it's really nitrogen and phosphorus nutrient-containing material. And again, surface water is basically is measured from the edge of surface water. It basically includes perennial and intermittent streams. Does include ephemeral streams. It doesn't include what we're calling a field ditch. The key is a field ditch is not considered setback requirement and or a stream unless it's flowing water 365 days a year. So it kicks it back into that other category. And then assuming it does meet that criteria, it still has to meet A, B, or C. So most field ditches, what we're going to think about, probably don't need a setback. But it's just something to be aware of. Again, something you're consulting, dressing in your plan, it should be clear to you. Again, they went into effect in January of 14. Basically, assuming that you had to have a setback, you got to have a permanent 10-foot vegetative buffer that's basically not going to have a crop. And it could require a 35-foot setback from the surface water of any broadcast NRP, nitrogen or phosphorus. If you're banding it, direct spraying it, in other words, out of a boom, you basically don't need the 35-foot setback. It's just a 10. So it's slinging, as I'll call it. Slinging manure, slinging fertilizer. That's where the setback would apply, assuming it applies. That's how it's enforced. Again, it does apply to pasture, so that's something, you know, if cattle in the stream, it's getting attentions in other parts of the state, so that's all being trying to be addressed. That's talking about livestock and sacrifice lots. This basically is just a table that kind of shows what I just talked about. That's all it is. Needless to say, if it's a stream, natural or it's perennial and or intermittent, it's a stream, a setback applies. If it's channelized, which hence really means it's a ditch, and it's perennial, which means it's flowing water 365 days a year, then again, and it's A, B, or C, then they're calling it a stream, so a setback applies. If it's just channelized, a ditch, but it's intermittent, doesn't flow continually, then it's a ditch and setbacks do not apply. So it's just something to keep in the back of your mind to be aware of. And that just talks, kind of gives a description of how we're measuring it to some degree. Again, setbacks are required to be addressed in your nutrient management plan by your consultant. We're not expecting you to figure out where it goes, but it's just something that hopefully your consultant's addressing, explaining it to you. It's going to be your requirement to implement it if it comes into play. There's some gray areas in some of this. Don't get me wrong. I think it's like everything else. We can kind of deal with the obvious. The gray ones, we're going to work our way through. If you see something, got a question about something your consultant thinks you do, call us, ask us. We'll certainly get involved if need be to try to make sure we're capturing what needs to be captured. PMT. Jump right into PMT. Again, those regulations became effective in June of 15. Basically, it's getting phased in over 7 years. There's a two-year transition period, which basically means we're running PSI, our current tool, and PMT to show farmers this is the impact that it may have to you and to your situation. That's 2016 and 2017, and then there's 5 years of phasing it in after that, depending on your situation. Again, the five-year phase-in is 2018 to 2022, so yeah, it'll probably be here before we know it. But again, the first next 2 years, your consultant's going to run both. They should be in your plan, assuming this applies to you. So you can kind of get your eyes open to say, well, would I have to do anything different in this scenario? This is something that Hans talked about. Part of the PMT regulations when they were passed required certified consultants, license holders, that's people writing plans, were required to file a report with the department last September. And basically it says every 6 years thereafter of soil test phosphorus levels by management units and or by your fields. As he alliterated, I think 800 and some thousand acres we've gotten so far out of 1.2 expected, so that's 70-80%. So needless to say, we don't have them all, so that is a concern. There has been some follow-up from the department trying to get that. So as a farmer, I would encourage you to talk to your consultant and say, hey, did you send my stuff in? You know. But again, that's a requirement. So I'm confident to say there will be some follow-up of the ones that we didn't get. But I don't know how that's going to play out at this point. But again, that's something that it was a requirement. So again, the state hopefully can go to Annapolis or wherever and say, this is what we've got reported. This is where we see the high phosphorus. This is where we don't see high phosphorus. These are the acres. Based on PMT, assuming it applies to you, and again, the key is it doesn't apply to you until your soil test is 150 FIV or greater on phosphorus, and you're still trying to use P. That's when it comes into play to look at what's the environmental risk here. But again, with the phase in, you're going to get that farm, assuming it applies, it's going to get placed into one of three categories. You're going to get into a tier C, a tier B, or a tier A. And that basically is going to tell you how and when you have to transition. So it's basically giving people an opportunity to walk in. Again, it's phased in over time. The intent is to phase it in based on the risk. The guys with the biggest risk are going to start the first, but they're going to get the most time to get to the ultimate goal if that's what needs to be done. Again, the farms with the greatest impact, put into those tiers. The tiers are defined based on soil test phosphorus FIV levels. Basically, what's got to be done is your operation will get classified. There's going to be information submitted to MDA to say, well, this is what's the average FIV over 150. So all it does is within your operation, any soil test that you have 150 or greater will all get added together, divided by that number, will give you an average over 150 FIV. So if I had a 150 and a 250, and that's all I got, add them together, divide by 2, my average is 200. Pretty simple. So low ones don't dilute you. It's all based on what's in within my operation. That's anything that I'm managing. Again, the calculation is done one time just to get you in a tier, to get you on the transition schedule, if that's where we're going. Again, tier C is the ones with the highest levels, like he alluded to. If you're over 500, you're immediately cut off. But if you're 450 to 500, we'll say, so in other words, you're kind of close to the top, you're the ones that are going to start to transition first, but you're going to get 5 years to get to the ultimate goal. If you're tier B, your average is between 300 and 450. But again, you're going to start a year later, and you're just going to have 4 years to get there. You can start sooner, but this is going to be minimum standards, I'll call it. Tier A is saying my average is somewhere between 150 and 300. So you're the ones that are in the lower tier. Again, you're going to be a little later to start. You're basically going to we're all going to get to the same point, hopefully, at the same time, which is 2022. Again, Tier C, which was the ones with the, you know, in 2018 and 19, will implement, that's the ones with the highest levels, the 450, are going to start a two-year transition phase, and it's kind of phased in, like, we're going to do this for 2 years, and then we're going to step it up to this, and then we're going to get to PMT. Again, ultimately, we're implementing PMT come 2022. The next group is the same thing. We're still trying to get to 2022 implementation, but they're going to do a little phase in a little different. So, again, that's something that you will be informed if and when we get to that point that applies to you. Again, phased in over time, phased in over the risk. And everything means a little something different as we go along. Basically, I think the simplest thing is there's a table, just to make it a little simple, that kind of lays out how it's going to work out to some degree. But the key now is if a soil sample is 500 or greater PFIV, no additional P can be applied. This is in effect now. That was passed immediately when that PMT was passed in June of 15. So if you have a soil sample that's 500 or greater, it can not get any P from any source at all immediately. There's not many of them. I think they alluded to 1% or something, but there's certainly not a lot of them, but there's a few. Again, if it's basically, if your soil test is between 150 and 499, then it's going to apply to you. Again, if you're less than 150, it doesn't apply to you. So it doesn't apply to everybody, but some people need to be aware of. Again, PMT changes the management. PMT is a little more, I guess, restrictive is the word, than PSI. It's looking at subsurface drainage of water is something that's a big driver in this tool that wasn't quite as big of an impact in what we've been dealing with. And that's a big issue as you get further down the shore where it gets more ditches, more poorly drained soil at some degree. Distance to surface water is the key. This degree of P saturation is something that's kind of new. that's something that we've all got to get to, assuming we got to run PMT. What that is a calculation that's done by your soil lab, generally, that looks at what's the saturation, how saturated is my soil, my sponge. Your soil type and my soil type might be totally different. I'm on a sand hill and he's in a clay hole. They got different capabilities of holding phosphorus. So even though we may have the same soil test level, my sponge may be fuller than his sponge. That's kind of, in a sense, it's saying, what's the degree of saturation here? I know here on the Eastern Shore, AgriLab, Delaware, which is here today, they routinely report this on a soil sample. University of Delaware reports it. All labs are capable of reporting it. And I know there's been some conversation with those labs, you know, the Spectrums, A&L, which I think is now Waypoint. So they're gearing up to do that. In the interim, if that's not been done, there's actually a calculation that can be done to do with the iron and aluminum in the soil to come up with a value. But it's really not the best way to go. So that's something that's kind of new to people, something to be thinking about. Again, if you're transitioning, you know, you're going to basically, you run the PSI or the PMT, you get a score. If your score is 0 to 50, you're basically just put in a low category, says you're a low risk. If you're 51 to 100, you're medium. If you're over 100, you're high. And again, based on your score, based on what category you're put into, tier A, B, or C, which is between 2018 and 2022, you're going to phase in basically in transition management 1 or transition management 2, ultimately stepping you up to PMT. This is it in a nutshell. Look at it, to me, this table makes more sense if you kind of look at it sometimes backwards. So if PMT said I'm low risk, ultimately when you have to implement PMT, which would be 2022, you're going to be limited to 3 years worth of crop phosphorus removal in an application. Basically, in the phased-in thing, it's really one and the same. Because low risk, they're basically saying it's N-based the first year in phase one, but you still can't exceed 3 years of crop removal. Well, to me, those are identical. If you're a medium risk, again, come PMT 2022, you're going to be limited to 1 year's worth of crop phosphorus removal. That's the maximum you can put on at any given time. In the transition, they're going to start you off and say, well, we're going to limit you to 3 years worth of P removal in the transition, might be 18 and 19. Then we're going to step you up to 20 and 21. They're going to say, well, we're going to cut you back to 2 years, but next year you're headed to here. So it's just a phase weaning you off of it, if that's what you want to call it. High risk, basically, in PMT, running that calculation, you're going to get to PMT and it says you cannot apply that P, is what it's basically saying. You can't apply an additional P. In the transition, they're going to cut you back to 1 year's worth of crop removal. They're going to cut you to half of a year's worth of crop removal to cut you basically over here to zero. I mean, so that's something. In the next 2 years, your consultant runs the PMT, comparison with the PSI. PSI is still regulatory. It may say, go do what you're doing. But PMT might say, oh, high risk. The key is, that's where it's going to lead you down the road. So you need to be thinking about, is there something I can do? Maybe there is, maybe there isn't. But that's kind of how it's set up to get to this ultimate goal. Leave that scenario, just talk a little bit about implementation reviews. It's something we do all the time. That's basically the focus of what we're doing. We're doing them year round. Again, in fiscal year 2015, throughout the state, MDA conducted 890 audits. 772 of those were completely random. That's the bulk of what we do. 118 were targeted. Targeted in a sense because someone thinks there's something going on. Generally, it's something to do with the annual report. They either didn't file it, they didn't fill it out correctly, something looks funny, you know, so that varies. So that's something we do follow up on to some degree. Again, from the random reviews, there was 69% that showed compliance, which ultimately says there's 30-some percent that weren't in compliance. Those get people riled up sometimes.
Very riled up.
Yes. So, I mean, we all got to try to do our part. And my goal was, yes, to regulate you, but my goal was also to help you get there. You know, if you got questions, you don't understand, your consultant's asking you to do something, you say it don't make no sense, let's talk about it. You know, we got to try to figure out why. But again, from the targeted reviews, you kind of going in there with the note that there's probably something wrong. Well, you can see we had 28% compliance when you target them. So, but again, you average all that together sometimes. Again, it's a review, basically. The implementation review is a review of generally your latest nutrient management plan compared against your nutrient application records. You know, that's where record keeping is extremely important. We're looking at how did what you're doing comparing to what your plan is, what are you missing, what are you not. The worst case scenario you're going to get that day is a warning that says, this is a problem, you've got to pay attention, here's what you need to do to fix it, here's an opportunity to get there. You know, it's not a crisis. Again, may need to verify, again, we're sitting in your office or wherever, it's wherever the paperwork is. But again, we may need to verify, that's something that's kind of coming in, if there's needs to be a buffer or a setback, it's something that we may have to verify that, hey, we can visually see that it's in place. Again, just focusing on my region only, which was Kent, Queen Anne's, Talbot counties in fiscal year 2015, I did 136 random reviews. I did none targeted. So that tells you this region is doing a good job. As a rule, we're not seeing too many problems, you know, at face value, where you can look around the state, and evidently there are somewhere. But again, based on my random reviews, 76.5% were in compliance. So again, we're better than average through the state, but we got to keep up the work.
So what makes up that other percentage? What are you seeing mostly in the non-compliance?
Generally, when it's non-compliance in my region, it's either the plan is generally incomplete. We get a few that aren't current, but it's incomplete. They flat out didn't address something that needed to be addressed. And then occasionally it's over-application of nitrogen or phosphorus, depending on something. And 9 times out of 10, that, to my experience, has been it's because the farmer really didn't understand what he was supposed to do, which I hate to say it, but it's kind of the fault to me to some degree of the consultant. They haven't had a good conversation. I hate it when I have to go there and explain to the man what his plan said for him to do last year, and he's like, no one ever told me that. I said, well, it's here in black and white. Someone should have explained it to you. The key to me is hopefully your consultant explains it to you. But when you get home and no one wants to do this, read it. Read what it says. Circle things that jump out at you. Look at your recommendations and say, they want me to do this over here, but I can do that over there. And you need to understand why. And if you don't understand why, ask. Jenny's question was, do I see a lot of overuse on starter? I'm not sure what you mean as in you.
No.
And that's the key. Again, if you've looked at your plan and you're seeing that it says 0 P and you're thinking in my heart, well, I know damn well I'm going to use P because I'm going to put starter on my corn. Or I'm going to, Southern States said that we're only going to use this product. Then you need to get it addressed. 9 times out of 10, if your plan is written properly and things are done accordingly, you can probably use it. But it's just got to be addressed. Yes, sir?
Howard, working with it in both sides of the court, is there any way for the ones that are just a plan's not quite complete or something like that where there could be like a 2-week grace period where the person could update it and then as an industry we could call it they were in compliance? Because the other side of the world thinks the out of compliance is someone's dumping 100 tons of extra nitrogen on the field when it might just be a one-day paperwork issue.
Correct. And I understand that. I'm not, you know, those are the people you need to preach that to Hans and to Joe. And, I mean, I can certainly take the message. But, again, I don't get to make a lot of the decisions. You know, I kind of get told this is what you're going to do. I certainly can give input. But yes, I mean, the perception is when someone's out of compliance, and they, like you say, it's a paperwork issue, 99% of the time, in my heart of hearts, they really aren't causing a pollution problem. But that's the perception the non-ag community gets, is that they're dumping something into the creek.
Right.
And I think they want that information, how much, they want to know.
Well, I mean, from our...
We don't want to know that someone missed a check, didn't check a box or forgot a field.
Right. And we have that data. I mean, I didn't put it here, but we could go through and say, here's from that whatever percent, this was this. I mean, we've got them. Correct. That's true. I understand it. I appreciate your comment.
Yeah. In 2014, I think only 3% was from misapplication. But, you know, they see that third 20%, 15%, they get all bumpy.
Right.
But a lot of it is just paperwork. That's, you know.
You're not allowed to ask questions, so put your hand up. Yes.
Talking about reading the plan, mention that's the time that if they see something that's not right for their operation, acres wrong crop, do it right then, go back to the consultant. Don't wait until July or sometime.
Correct.
Try to get it fixed while the guy's a little over there.
That's correct. I mean, that's the key, is if you see, look at your plan, understand your plan. I was just somewhere, we'll say this week, and the comment was made, you know, and I'm reading it, and the comment was made, nobody reads that stuff. I'm like, well, it was in there for a reason. You should have read it at least once, you know. And I know sometimes it's like, oh, it's like dealing your taxes. I ain't going to do that. Take it to the accountant. He'll put it all together. Well, they do the same thing with the consultant. I took him in when he wanted, and he gave me something back. But I'm going to go home and do what I'm doing, you know. And if it fits, so be it. If it don't, I'll deal with it, you know. Again, the key to keep compliance, keep your plans current, keep them up to date. That's as things revolve. I've added acreage. I'm growing new crops. Whatever it is, your plan should clearly tell you when it was written and when someone thinks you need to update it and what circumstances you would need to update it. Again, keep records of all nutrient applications, fertilizer, manure, sludge, whatever it is, anything that's applied. Again, keep records of yields that you're harvesting, because all of that is using data to support your plan, that the way it's written, that we're comfortable that it's accurate. Again, your guide for fertility. Again, if it talks about setbacks, it's in there for a reason. You need to implement that if that's the key. And then again, nutrient applicator vouchers need to be current. Vouchers are required if you're doing 10 acres worth of nutrient applications per year yourself. So in a nutshell, that's kind of about, I think, all I've pretty well got. I'm here today. There's how to get a hold of me. I don't care if it's somewhere else in the state. If you want to call me, email me, I'm here. Anybody else got any more burning questions while I'm here? Something I went through, you didn't understand, you want to reiterate, fine. If you want to do it one-on-one later, that's fine too. Yes?
If someone, could you walk through the process if someone's using a variable rate nitrogen tool?
Such as Greensig?
And it bumps them over. What's the process of the paperwork application beforehand? I don't know
the
process.
Can you just repeat the question?
Yeah. I think the question was, what's the process for someone that's using variable rate nitrogen applications? Is there paperwork that needs to be done when you're going to be exceeding your plan? Is that kind of what I'm saying?
Is that a beforehand?
Yes. Right. Basically, if you know ahead of time, to some degree, that I'm going to do something out of the ordinary. I don't know what the right word is, but that basically may put me over. There's an application, I'll call it. There's a form with MDA that you can do for demonstration purposes. Well, basically, It lets us know what's going on. There's requirements of data that has to be kept for records. It has to be shared back with us, because the ultimate goal is to learn if that's something that needs to be adopted so more people than you can use it, nutshell.
Is that before application, or is it like if it bumps us over?
You need to do it now. I mean, right now you're limited to your nutrient management plan. And what I've seen some cases, people doing variable rate, kind of what we're going to look at in reality is, did you go over the average for the field? Does that make sense? In other words, I may have had 10 rates out there, but if you take the total, divide by the acres, the way the plan's written, is that over? If that is, it's going to throw up a big red flag. If you've just moved it around in there a little bit, it's probably going to go on through kind of with, we'll say, under the radar screen. So I know Greensig is something that's being discussed again now. It's in the process. I mean, it's beyond me. I know it's in Annapolis, but that's something that's being looked at right now currently.
Kind of along the same lines, if I take a tissue sample on June 15th and my crop says it needs more nitrogen, and I'm going to go over my plan, what's the process there?
I'd say at a minimum, call your nutrient management specialist and let's discuss it, because that is not your get-out-of-jail-free card at this point. Tissue tests, it's a fuzzy area. I mean, I don't want to say we're not going to allow it. University of Maryland doesn't seem to have much guidance or research on, at least that's my perspective, and they seem awful hesitant to want to support that. But I think it's a tool, that is one more tool like GreenSeek or anything else that I think we need to learn to adapt to. So.
Well, the regulations have to keep up with the technology.
Correct, that's correct.
If we're doing better than regulations, then.
Correct, but we got to be able to support and or defend the reasoning someone thought it was okay for you to put on more nitrogen, and you're always going to get that devil's advocate on the other side to say, well, what did that man do that he could have done different to that point so he didn't have to put more on? Is it because his crop is special and needs more than a pound of N per bushel of corn? Or is it because his management was a little fuzzy and he put it all on the day he planted? And short term today, he's got a problem. But long term, can we get him to change his management over here? So hopefully we avoid that. There's always, I don't say always, but there's a lot of times there's circumstances beyond our control that we have to adapt to. And at least from my understanding, from MDA's perspective, we don't want to hurt you in that scenario. So I think the key is document what you're doing, document weather events that you think may have had an effect on you, do the tissue test. I'm comfortable saying those scenarios, we're going to let you adjust to the best of our ability. Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Howard. As you know, during our Agronomy Day, the sponsors are here. They pay some money to be here so we can have this really nice lunch that we are going to have later. So I'll ask a couple of them to come up. First, we have Meha Suri. Meha works with the University of Maryland. She's with the Ag Law Initiative Program. So, Meha.
Hey, y'all. Good morning. My name is Meha Suri, like Jenny said. I work with the Ag Law Education Initiative, which is a partnership with the University of Maryland, University of Maryland Eastern Shore, and the University of Maryland Law School in Baltimore. So I always like to tell people that when they ask us, so what do? I say, well, we translate laws into English that people actually speak and actually can read and understand. So as you all know, probably better than anyone in the state, a lot of Maryland laws, it's like they were written for a lawyer to read and not for the people who really need to understand them to read. So that's where we come in. We try to put them in language that I can understand, so that you all really know what you're dealing with and someone doesn't come into your door and say, hey, you're out of compliance, and you say, well, I didn't even know what the law was because I couldn't understand it. So we have some high-tech stuff. We have a blog, we have a website that we update pretty regularly, and then we also have a hotline you can call. We also come around with our printed out publications. We have a table in the back. We cover topics like estate planning, we have a farm brewery guide, labor laws, basically anything you can think of. And we also always welcome questions and suggestions for topics to cover. So I hope that we have some good information for you today, and thank you.
Thanks, Meha. Thank you. Thank you. Meha works with Paul Goringer, and a lot of you have seen him, and he's here today. So let's see. Next, we have Grant Troop, and he's with Ag Explorer. So, Grant, thank you.
Thank you. I mentioned just a couple of our products. We're out in the display area. One is Endzone. Some of you may have heard of that technology. It was developed about 9 years ago to manage nitrogen, and we brought it to the market because when we treated our nitrogen source with Endzone, we saw higher plant sap nitrogen during the growing season, which led to higher yield. We've done additional testing on this product, and in the past 4 years of testing, we averaged in the test plots, and this is done by independent researchers. We're in five land-grant universities having it evaluated now. We averaged 47% reduction in nitrate leaching. Think about that fact, 47%. A lot of the other nitrogen management materials were in a test. The closest competitor was 16%. So if you can manage nitrogen and keep 47% less leaching going on, that should be a huge benefit for a crop yield. That product also does control some volatilization if you're putting your nitrogen on the surface. We do have a version for anhydrous, and I understand the anhydrous in this particular area, guys that are using it, do not treat your anhydrous. So you're leaving it open to leaching. And we do have a version that can go right in with your anhydrous application. And then we did add NBPT to that product so you can completely control ammonia volatilization. As good as Agritain and other products. So if you're putting nitrogen on the surface, not getting it worked in right away, you want to protect your investment. And then we have a product for phosphorus called Prevent. That product is designed to protect the phosphorus you put on the ground so it's not tied up and fixed in the soil right away by other minerals. And also has components that free up the fixed phosphorus in the soil. Going ahead, I can see these kind of tools being very important for us to be high-producing farmers. Thank you.
Okay, let's see who's next. Chris, my son, Chris Rhodes. Chris is now selling Axis Seed.
As she said, me and my brother are selling Axis Seed under Tidewater Seed. We have a booth in the back if anybody's interested. I know most people have all their sales orders in, but if you have anything else you need we can help you with, we'd be glad to do that. We also have some 4-2 and some 3-9 extend beans that have been released also. So we'll be in the back if we can help you. Thank you.
All right. Good job, Chris. Mark Saltonfuss is here from Nagel Farm Service, Nagel Crop Insurance.
That kind of just comes out.
Yeah. Good morning, everybody. Glad to be here. Jenny, thanks for putting this on. It's a great opportunity for people to get their credits and hear some of the late-breaking news from the university and the MDA. Our package of crop insurance, we sell the same product that everybody else sells as far as crop insurance goes. What makes us a little different from everybody else is we can show you how to utilize that crop insurance as the foundation of your grain marketing plan, utilizing it and leveraging your APH to select an opportunity to pick marketing strategies that will protect you from downside risk and give you some options for upside potential. I want to remind everybody, look at your crop insurance policy. Make sure you have it in front of you. If your entities have changed, make sure that that's accurate before March 15th, whatever status your marital status is. If you're married, newly married, or if you're no longer married, those things, if there's an SBI that needs to be removed, those little details in your crop insurance policy, you really need to pay attention to that. So we have a booth back there. We have a bi-monthly webinar on marketing that we'd love to have you participate. You can participate from home, or you can come into one of our offices and watch it on Tuesday morning at 7:30. So if you're interested in that or how we can put together a risk management protection for you, look us up, give us a call, and talk to us. Thank you.
Okay, we'll have one more. Bill Rohr is here from AgriLab before we get started with our next speaker. So thanks, Bill.
Yeah. Good morning. Thank you, Howard. Good morning, Jenny. You do a great job here. This is a great event. My name is Bill Rohr. I own AgriLab. I'm actually a Caroline County resident, do some farming, and the lab is in Harrington. I'm an agronomist, so we provide agronomic services to a lot of you in the room and others, so I'm grateful that you've given us an opportunity to be a part of your business. So it is a relatively young business, so we're excited as we grow. And provide additional agronomy support. So if there's primarily what we do is soil, plant tissue, manure, fertilizer, feed, water. We're doing some water analysis primarily for the fruit and vegetable folks who want to be certified under the GAP program to make sure there aren't any food safety issues with E. coli. We're starting to mess around a little bit with Listeria and Salmonella, even though that's not required under the GAP program. If there's only one or two pieces of information I'd like to pass on to you from an agronomist perspective, really it's critical as you look at your soil data to make sure that pH is right. pH is the gatekeeper for a lot of nutrients. So you may have nutrients in that soil, but they aren't plant available because of the pH. soybeans, it's particularly, it's very important. Your nodule formation really doesn't produce a whole lot. It's very weak once you get down in the mid fives. So it's a, soybeans are a lot more sensitive to crops like corn and wheat. And then the last piece of information, three nutrients I'd like you to focus on every year. It's your classic mobile nutrients, nitrogen, sulfur, and boron. So if you're not managing them every growing season, you're probably going to have problems with them. And I still think that one of the greatest challenges to grow big corn in our area is nitrogen management. And I think Dr. Kratovall is going to talk a little bit about that. Interesting things happening in technology and with seed varieties. You know, in general, you know, only about 60 to 70% of your nitrogen is taken up, you know, at that, you know, from your planting to your tassel stage. So there's still a significant amount of nitrogen that you need to finish that crop out. So don't get into the habit, you know, if you have the opportunity to spread that nitrogen application out through the growing season, I can assure you it will increase your yield and it will increase your nitrogen efficiency. So that's a little more than my 30 seconds. Thanks and have a great day. Okay.